everybody, I'm Peter Achterberg. I'm a professor of sociology. I'm a cultural sociologist. I started out as a political sociologist early, let's say 10, 12 years ago or something. And I did some work on why people actually vote for all kinds of parties. And I did some work on why actually the working class isn't voting for leftist parties no longer, right? And I think yesterday evening we witnessed that tremendously well in the Netherlands. This is more or less the general theme of my lecture for today. But first things first, which party did you vote for yesterday? So I was a little bit scared because, I entered this room this building, and then Kim said, there's an election. And I thought, oh God, I've also planned for an election, but she was polling for something differently than I am. So I want to you to grab your phone, go to www.menti.com and enter this code 160084, and then you get to vote. But if you have a QR scanner, you can also use this one, or go to this website, and it doesn't really matter which route you take, just answer the question, which party did you vote for yesterday? I would really, really appreciate that. Does it work? Yeah? Okay, while you are voting, our university magazine, perhaps you know it, Universe Online, do you know it?
Yes.
Yeah? They also polled, basically the political sentiment of the university, and, we don't know which part, which respondents or which groups of students and staff actually answered this question. But, the results aren't in any way representative, but I thought it gave a nice illustration. So I just want to present you the results while are you scanning now or doesn't work? Okay, are you able to vote or yeah? Okay. So these were the results. So based on the poll by Universe, D66, Alexander Pechtold, you would almost get a majority in the parliament, followed by Jesse Klaver, and then Rutte. That's it. So now I'm wondering what you actually did, right? And again, this is in no way representative, but I just wanted to find out, right? Just a little hook. So, I already opened this, but not here, apparently. Okay, look at that. It converges nicely. And, here, somebody, that's you, right? Okay, so, what do we see? D66, that's also the most popular party here in this room, followed by the Greens and then the Liberals. I would actually had expected, given the Christian profile of our university, that the Christian Democrats would have gotten some more votes, but apparently you don't like Buma. this converges actually quite nicely. So what can we see? What is so striking here for a sociologist? What is so striking here? I think GroenLinks can be qualified as a left party and also SP.
The fact that university students and also the alumni of the university have a really different profile as the rest of the Netherlands.
Exactly, because, basically these two parties, right, and especially the Dutch PVV, that's an interesting party. A right-wing party, you might say. I'm not polling you on your profession, but I can guess it, right? It's a professional class type profession, right? You all earn a lot of money, I think. Well, at least more than those in the Schilderswijk or in Rotterdam Zuid or somewhere in Tilburg beyond the railway track, right? No? Sorry. I'm trying to display a lot of knowledge of Tilburg, but actually I have none. So, okay. But the PVV, is a right-wing party, as is the VVD, but they don't get any votes here, which is totally different from our national results, right? So the PVV is second party in the Netherlands at this moment, right? This might change because Wednesday will be the real election results, but still it's quite a big party. And here at the university, nowhere at universities, people are thinking of considering voting for a populist party, right?
It's really a right-wing party because, well, for immigrants, yes.
Yeah. There is a couple of political scientists doing research on this, and well, basically what they do is they voice this, but they don't vote like this, right? So on these issues, they are rather right-wing at the same time. So, but you're absolutely right. It is not a classical right-wing party. It's a different type of party. It's a populist party. Oh, well, I'm clicking, but nothing's happening. So. Okay, so based on these results of the polls of the students and the staff, and now of our alumni, you might think that if you take a look at these polls, that we are back in the good old days in which we were the guiding country of the rest of Europe, right? So everywhere in Europe there were people voting for populist parties like Vlaams Belang or FPE or Le Pen in France. But here nothing happened, right? So we considered ourselves, well, okay, we have no racist parties. We have Jan Maat, well, that's it, but he doesn't get any votes, so that's not a problem at all. So we actually thought that we were a tolerant nation, united in our tolerance, in our multiculturalism, and not having these kinds of ideas, right? And based on these thoughts, or on these findings you provided, you might still think this, but this simply isn't true, right? So, because like in France, or like in Hungary, or like in Austria, we also have the populist now, right? Since Pim Fortuyn entered the political stage, we have witnessed a succession of all kinds of populists at the right end of the political spectrum, filling this gap, right? People have discovered that we are not a guiding country, we are just like the rest, right? So if you take a look at these pictures, right, what do you notice? Ah, yeah, that's because of my personal hobby. I like, gathering these photos, right? I think they're kind of nice. Probably they want to have a couple of photographs of them humanizing themselves, like they can actually care for living beings, yeah? Yeah?
And that's Hitler.
Ah.
His dog.
Yeah.
So that's really funny. Why are these people with the animals very important and why are these pictures interesting?
Well, I think they are funny, but
I think the similarity.
Yeah, there's a huge similarity, but probably this is selective, right? So I just wanted to have a couple of pictures. But probably there are also pictures of Rutte with a cat or a parrot or something like that. I don't know, but we could do research on this, right? Or right?
Already have for one King Willem on his horse here in Tilburg. King Willem on the
Oh, yeah.
On his horse.
Yeah, and there's also a Princess Marijke. She likes to hug trees and do so and do things with animals. So I'm hug them, of course, nothing else. Okay. So if you take a look at these pictures, they are interesting, but what's missing? Humans, particularly one, which we have all been talking about for, let's say, a half a year, or 1.5 years. Thank you very much. Here. He also has a dog or a cat or something, right? Okay. Hmm? Okay. So this Orban and Hofer and Wilders and Le Pen and Trump, and I could go on and on. These are all populists, right? But if we would go to Latin America, we would also find populists. I also have pictures of them with cats or parrots. I'm not showing them right here, but I have them. But these are a rather different type of populists. These are left-wing type of populists, and these are all right-wing populists. And I'm only focusing today on these kinds of populists. And I'm asking what unites them besides their preference for animals? What unites them, right? And why is it so attractive for people to vote, to want to vote for these kinds of populists? Because as you can see here, and these are taken from nu.nl, and I think these are the rather official numbers, 20 seats at this moment are projected to be won by Wilders next Wednesday. Right? So that's a lot. Another interesting feature is here, the great demise of the Dutch Labour Party, which I will come back to at the end of the presentation, predicting or actually explaining why this should be so. Okay, so I'm going to discuss two major features of populism. And the first is, it's always a little bit hard to talk about populism without explaining what that is, right? Because if I would ask all of you what populism is, then probably no one would have the same answer. And that's okay, because it's a social construct, and we can use that social construct in a way, right? And we can construct our own definition of populism and then use this. And there, basically, in the literature, there's some sort of convergence on two definitions of populism at this moment, right? When it applies to Western types of populism. And this is the first, and this is the most general one. It is basically the idea that populism isn't much besides the idea that there's the people at large, the people who have a lot of common sense, who know everything, who have gone through the university of life, who have the wisdom, and which is homogeneous on one hand, and then there's the elite. And these elites are completely corrupt. Everything which goes wrong is basically a product of the elites, right? So I don't know whether there are any fans of the Spelt here. Do you know the Spelt? Yeah, they have cool movies of the Partij tegen de Burger. You know it? I like it, right? These are great because, well, basically they use this populist discourse and basically say, well, these are our policies. So they say things like, well, we go out of our way to mess up all of your lives, right? As soon as people aren't happy, we are happy, right? And we can only do this together, right? So things like that, and I like it. But this is basically populism then, right? In the first sense, populism as an antagonism, as a continuing battle between the good and the bad, and the good is the people, and the bad is the elite. And it doesn't say much about whether this is right-wing or left-wing. It basically only says that, well, the people at large, the good, are opposed to the bad, right? The corrupt elites, and that's it. And then which type of ideological policies they want to embrace or not it's not a given. So this may also apply to Hugo Chavez in Latin America and to Wilders, right? Okay, so this populism, and that's interesting. But then the question is, what explains the rise of such populism? And I don't know. Are there any? No, we don't have political scientists in the house. But are there people here who have read something within political sociology? No, because this is Giovanni Sartori. He's kind of the founding father of political sociology. And he has written a lot of very influential texts within political sociology. And one of those texts is about the structure of politics. And what he says is that within politics, there are basically two dimensions. There's the redemptive side, the ideological side on the one hand, and there's the pragmatic technocratic side on the other hand. So to give an illustration of what that is, and I'm my apologies for keeping my illustrations from Dutch examples, but there is this example of Arjen Lubach. No, Arjen Lubach? Yeah. Okay, he made a movie or a little I don't know, Zondag met Lubach, I don't know how to call that, a sketch on Wilders. And what he constantly says is, who dan? How? How can we do this? Right? You say all kinds of stuff, but how can we do it? How? Give us your technocratic solutions for all your stupid ideas, right? This is the basic, and this question of how can we reach certain goals? How can we make sure that our policies stick? That's the technocratic side of politics, right? It's not about having the grand visions or the ideas or the great view or the mission or something like that. It's just basic. Well, you've got a problem. I'm going to find a solution in this way or that way. Something like that. It's a pragmatic side. And then there is the ideological side. And Wilders is actually quite good in this ideological side. Or let's say politicians from small orthodox Christian parties. These are great in the ideological redemptive side, right? And they can always answer the question, why? Right? This wasn't in Arjen Lubach's sketch, but you could, for instance, say to the Dutch Labour Party, why they have a problem with that, answering this question. Why? They probably, if you look at them, they are, all over the place. Some say this, some say that. They don't have a clear answer. If you say or ask Wilders, why? He has a clear answer. The Islam, it's bad, need to be erased, and then everything will be beautiful again. Something like that, right? It's not manageable, but he knows why he's saying this. When you ask Rutte, in the he did a lecture, Hoge Schoollezing, I think it was. Then he said, okay, let's first get rid of this elephant in the room, a vision. Who needs a vision, right? Basically says, don't ask me why, right? Okay, that's the other side. It's a more redemptive side of politics in which ideologies play a bigger role, right? So these are just the two sides. A last example, Barack Obama. Barack Obama, when he campaigned, he was completely on the redemptive side. There was hope. Yes, we can. Everybody was following him. But as soon as he took office, then the technocratic side took over, right? This is what happened. Okay, so, and then there's Margaret Canavan, and she basically uses these two dimensions to explain the rise of populism. Because, this is what she says, that if these two dimensions of populism are in balance, everything is okay. If, people within the political system design new policies, solve problems, and they know why, everything is okay. But as soon as technocratic politics take over completely and they don't have an eye for this redemptive side of politics, for this vision, or for basically answering the question why we should want this, then people get dissatisfied. They don't want this. They also want some vision, some leadership from the political elites. And if they don't get it, then they will start to revolt. And then there will be some sort of automatic reaction, adjustment of the system in the form of populist parties. They don't care about the why, about the how. They only care about the why. And they adjust this system again. And now this is what you see, right? And it can be left-wing, it can be right-wing, it doesn't really matter. In the United States, we've seen this also on the left-wing side with Bernie Sanders. He also has a better idea of why, right? He didn't make it, but it can also be on the left-wing side of politics. Yes? It's not a.
Can you repeat the question?
Oh, okay. Is it a better? He promised me I wouldn't notice him, and now he's talking to me. Okay. It's not necessarily a better vision. It's a vision. Whereas some politicians go out of their way to avoid having a vision because it might deter or alienate some voters. Populist parties have a vision, right? They have a vision, a grand vision of going back to a nation of the 1950s, where you could just simply be happy, right? Where there was no such thing as Islam messing up our whole country or something like that. And it's not a good vision or a better vision; it's a vision, right? Yeah. Some have, some do.
But that doesn't resonate with everyone.
No.
So that there is a vision, I would say.
Yeah, but not all left-wing parties have these, right? So in this theory by Canavan, she simply says that when political parties, ideologies basically, fade out a little bit, or aren't as strong as they used to be, then there's room for populism to rise. And actually, we can see this. For instance, now, after a cabinet with, let's say, Rutte and Samson, left and right, they can't have a clear ideological vision of where we are going. It's a technocratic cabinet. It's a good quality cabinet for arranging all kinds of stuff, technocratically, but they can't answer the big questions in life at this moment, right? And then populism must win, right? Because it's just a correction to the system. Earlier on, Pim Fortuyn entered the stage after a couple of purple cabinets, which were highly technocratic. They didn't have a vision except for everybody needs to work. We become very rich or something like that, right? And that's it. There wasn't any crisis. There wasn't a crisis of the Indian economy in which people got fed up with constantly being poor and the losers of modernity or something like that. No, that wasn't the case at all. They were just fed up with technocratic politics, and they started voting differently, right? Then the last one, that's Pippa Norris. And what she did was take these two dimensions and try to measure it. Try to measure it not at the political level, but at the societal level. Asking whether or not people, on the one hand, have a need for democracy, have all kinds of democratic aspirations, have all kinds of visions, basically, and at the same time being highly dissatisfied the way how democracy works at this moment, and distrust in politicians, etc. So on the one hand, they have aspirations, but they don't see them met by the politicians, right? So they want to change everything, They look to politics, to the democratic system, to change their lives for the better. They hope that these politicians have all kinds of big stories and grand narratives to satisfy their needs in this respect. But they simply do not trust these politicians anymore. They are highly dissatisfied at the same time with how democracy works.
So what you're telling me now is that people who vote for populist parties are actually very unsatisfied
mm-hmm.
and want to have their voices heard.
Mm-hmm.
So they are voting for a party. They are actually aware that's never going to be able to do the things they are saying. Is that the case now?
Probably, but I completely agree with you with the first couple of sentences you just said, but I don't know whether they are aware that they are that Wilders, for instance, isn't going to listen at all. They don't care, right? They just think that, well, he has a vision. He completely says what I think. They think, so he doesn't have to listen because he already knows. He voices our concerns, so it's not a problem at all, right? Yeah. Okay.
Hij snapte niks van, maar hij gaat niet meer mee. Hij gaat in het verzet.
Ja.
Ik bedoel, deze mensen zijn allemaal hoog opgeleid en hebben een mogelijkheid om controle over hun leven te hebben. Heel veel mensen hebben dat niet. Ik bedoel, ik heb dat wel. Er zijn heel veel dingen die werken gewoon niet, maar ik kom er wel mee. Ik heb de intelligentie om er wel mee te dealen.
Mm-hmm.
En dan moet ik wat. En dan is het van, fuck, hoe het gaat. En ik moet iets anders. En dan maakt het niet uit hoe het is.
Ja.
Zo. Ja.
So I'm just going to translate it a little bit. People who have lower degrees of education.
Or right? Less
influence. Yeah. And well, basically, this is an important explanation for why people actually vote for populist parties, right? They feel anomic. They have a lot of cultural discontent. They constantly see bureaucratic systems. They constantly see society being disorganized. They constantly feel that there's no real truth anymore or something like that. Everything has become unpredictable. And for us, or for you, or for higher educated, they like this, right? It gives them opportunities, and they embrace this basically, they see this as an opportunity to pick and choose whatever they like, and then take it as opportunities to develop themselves even further. For lower educated, for people with lower levels of cultural capital, this doesn't apply, right? They are already a little bit scared of this chaos. And they only want to restore order in the most strong way possible, right? And this is also why most populist parties are, let's say, law and order type of parties, which promise one thing, and that is to restore order to the nation, right? To make it simple again, and everything will be the same. Yeah?
So this will happen with Brexit? That's the reason for Brexit?
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And the question is, what's your thought? Because everybody was afraid this is going to happen in Holland.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't.
It did. Yeah.
To a certain extent, it didn't.
Well, for a sociologist, a majority or a minority is basically the same, right? I don't care. These phenomena exist in every country. So in Great Britain, in Poland, in Germany, in Austria, in France, in the United States, it's always the same, right? So even though some populists may be more popular than other populists, and there's no big populist revolution at this moment, it's roughly, 25% of the people who have these kinds of sentiments. And sometimes these sentiments are captured quite well by the populists of service at this moment, right? And sometimes it's not, and then they don't vote, or they vote, right?
And you said you're a cultural sociologist.
Yeah.
Which means basically
Ah.
Than the southern nations.
Yeah,
is
but
that correct?
Probably, but still, you can see that also in the Nordic countries, for instance, in Denmark, there's a Forsrit party, which has been the example for Wilders, right? So and also in Norway and in Sweden, we have Anders Breivik with probably the same sentiments. And there's all kinds of lowly educated, and perhaps the level might differ, but it's still the same, phenomenon, right? It's lowly educated people who have these kinds of feelings and want to do something about it, right? Which is also, in a way, a positive thing, right? Because, you can also give up on society. Yeah? Mm-hmm.
And apparently there's strong correlations, so exactly as you have, we have mentioned in here.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually live in a not really intelligent neighborhood of Tilburg.
In North, right?
Oh.
Actually in the South. Oh, okay. Yeah. Because I saw you reacting when I was discussing this.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's too generalizing. Yeah,
but
okay.
The house is more cheap, by the way. So.
That's why they all live there.
When I go home, I pass by all those windows. I saw quite so many windows have the poster of Wilders. Maybe you think maybe it's the time for me to move.
Yeah. Yeah.
The democracy and free of speech is really important factor or matter in the society.
Mm-hmm.
But in the other hand, I think actually countries without democracy, some countries are doing quite fine.
Yeah. Which ones? In Asia. Okay, yeah.
Even in the case, if we talk about North Korea, yeah?
Yeah.
because there's no comparison.
No, of course,
you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah.
The whole country is, there's no information.
Yeah, it is what it is. Yeah.
They just, because everybody is same poor in North Korea.
Yeah.
So they don't think some people are having a better life. They think everybody's the same, that's okay with me.
Mm-hmm.
So they are not necessarily unhappy.
Yeah.
And some countries in Asia, like China or Russia, okay, maybe Russia is recently not fantastic, but if you look at China, if you look at all those small Asian countries, they are doing quite okay economically.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, and also less social instability.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not saying that democracy is over weighted.
Yeah. But it is. Well, please let me continue a little bit with my story, but I'll be sure to come back to you on this. What people actually expect from democracy,
yeah.
Right? So, but it's later on in my slides, and otherwise it will be some sort of postmodern presentation, which I can do, of course, right? Sep or forth and back, but what I did was using the European Social Survey is basically replicating this idea of Pippa Norris, right? And here are the democratic aspirations, the high hopes people have for democracy, and it's operationalized by a couple of questions. For instance, also the idea that democracy is simply the best way to rule a country. They are very much in favor of people having a lot of say in how the nation is run, etc. And this is the trust in the political elites and trust in the political system. And it's much lower, right? And well, if you subtract these two, then you get some sort of gap. And this gap, this institutional confidence gap or this democratic deficit, that's basically interesting. And I did some research on these, and actually this is much more common among the lowly educated than among the highly educated. The highly educated have a lot of democratic aspirations, but they match it with a lot of trust in institutional elites. With political elites, they also think that, well, they are well-versed to, for instance, influence these political elites or let them know how they think, and they feel represented, right? So this, for them, the system works beautifully. But for the lowly educated, they score high on this gap. They are they think, well, democracy, that's okay. I like democracy. It's the only way to run a country. But at the same time, they distrust everyone who is in the political system. So when Wilders says, this is a fake parliament, or when Trump says, well, let's drain the swamp, it's meant for those guys, right? For those people who have this democratic deficit, because, well, they want democracy, but they still, they don't see it anymore. They don't see it working very well. And this confidence gap or this democratic deficit has two types of consequences. And well, the first is that they start voting on the edge. So on the edge of the political spectrum. So this is these are the voters for three parties, the Party for the Animals. And they score very, very high on this confidence gap. So they are pro-democracy, but against political elites. And PVV voters are matching their democratic deficit in a way, right? So they are also pro-democracy, but against political elites. And then SP voters also score relatively high. And then, well, you can see that, for instance, the Christian parties are much lower. So they match their democratic aspirations with their trust in political elites much more. Yeah. There it is. Okay. So in earlier days, there was D66 and the Greens. They wanted democratization. They wanted to give the nation more say. They wanted to give the people more say in what government actually does. But nowadays, we see stuff like this. Today, we are transferring power from Washington, D.C. and giving it back to the people. It has transferred to the right-hand side of the spectrum. And this is from the Social and Cultural Planning Office, Burgerperspectieve. It's number one of last year. Here's what they did. They compared, the voters for all kinds of parties in time and see what they thought about, a referendum, right? Should it be an instrument or not? And the interesting stuff is that here's D66, and here are the three parties which would later combine the Greens. They started out high, and they ended up low, right? They don't want this anymore, or they feel uneasy with this. And then there's a couple of new parties, and these are very much in favor of referenda at this moment. So where it first began as some sort of new left-wing type of idea, democracy, it now ends up as an extreme left-wing or right-wing idea, right? And that's something different, I would say. So when you take a look at, three groups based on this democratic deficit, the ones who don't have a democratic deficit, the support for radical democratization, which means which is a scale in this these data, which means, let's say, that government should adjust policies in the middle of a coalition period when the people want this. Every major policy change should be controlled by a referendum and these kinds of issues. And if you don't experience a democratic deficit, then your support for this types of radical democratization is much lower. But then, for the people who have a big democratic deficit, support is immense, right? So they want this, right? And that's logical in a way, because if you want democracy, if you have democratic aspirations, if you want to hear big, beautiful ideological stories, but you distrust the political system, then the only solution is to take power, to seize power yourself, right? And this is the only instrument they see which might do the trick. And the interesting thing is that there is some sort of changing discourse on democracy itself. In the earlier days, democracy was some sort of inclusive idea. If everybody enters democracy and discusses things, is heard, then we can come up with a solution which may not be perfect, but is more perfect than dismissing everybody, which is transferred to some sort of exclusive idea of democracy at this moment, right? So the majority rules, and the minority, however big this minority is, needs to shut up, right? So which is a totally different type of idea of democracy. We can see that in the Brexit referendum, right? So almost nobody voted. And then almost half of those people voted for Brexit, and half of them voted against this Brexit. And now we are going to leave the EU. Or the Ukraine referendum. You saw the same in the Netherlands. 30% of the people voted, and then 15% of the people said yes, and 15% said no. But the yes people, or I don't know how it was phrased, but those who were in favor of Ukraine were slightly in the majority, and now suddenly we need, right? It's a majority rule, so there's no inclusivity anymore, which is interesting to me, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but Wilders also voices the same ideas, right? Giving back politics to the nation. We maken Nederland weer van ons, right? This is his electoral slogan, actually. So, which is fine for those people. And also, there's a Forum for Democratie, and this was run by the lead man basically of the Ukraine referendum, right? So, well, exactly, right? This is the idea, and then you can also take a look at how this support for radical democratization is distributed across electorates, and you can see again the Party for the Animals, PVV and SP, those are the ones who like this stuff, right? And then at the lower end, it's D66, Christian Democrats, the Greens, etc. Right? They don't like this anymore. Yeah. Okay. So I don't know how much time do I have? Okay. So then the second dimension of populism, right? Because I announced I was going to discuss two definitions of populism. And this definition of populism is much more applicable only to the West European or the Western types of populism. So if you take a look at Latin America, it doesn't work, right? Because we can only find left-wing populists there. But here, in Europe and also in America, I would say, we find populism as nativism, and this is an ideology in which all non-native elements should be discarded. Everybody who wasn't born here, who isn't a member of the native tribe or something, needs to go. Which in America is a little bit problematic, because then. Right, there aren't any natives, but still they want to do something with that, and they have discourse against Islamic people, they have discourse against Latin American people, right? And they want to do away with those kinds of people, all non-native elements or ideas or culture or Bibles or Qurans or whatever, they need to go. That's not part of the original national culture, and it simply needs to go in favor of, well, the national idea of culture, right? And we can see this tremendously well in the Netherlands, right? In the Netherlands at this moment, everybody's constantly talking about our national identity all of the time. Wilders does it, it's his main reason, basically, for being in politics, right? It's nationalism and the fight against all non-native, read, Islamic elements at this moment, right? And this is a powerful idea. So the question is, what explains such populism, right? We've seen a populism of antagonism, but this is a different type of populism. It's ideological. And, again, the same format, basically. This is a book by Ronald Ingelhardt, The Silent Revolution. Has anybody read this? Has anybody ever heard of Ronald Ingelhardt? Yeah, you have. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So Ronald Ingelhardt was basically the inventor, or the one who made the term post-materialism popular. And you know, post-materialism, that's basically the idea that people increasingly start to emphasize all things which aren't related to materialist issues. So they don't care as much anymore about the economy. They don't concern about economic redistribution as much as they used to, but they tend to think about other stuff. They think about individual freedom. They think about cultural identity. They think about tolerance for deviant persons. They think about all kinds of other stuff which has nothing to do with the economy, basically, right? So, for instance, in politics, you always hear the phrase, it's the economy, stupid, right? Well, Ronald Ingelhardt would disagree with this to a certain extent, because he says politics increasingly becomes post-materialist, right? Non-material, non-economic issues are increasingly important. And he started out his work back in the 60s, 1960s, studying, well, the rise of the new left, right? And back in those days, this university was called the Karl Marx University. Remember? Are there any persons here? Okay, yeah. Did you like it?
No.
Oh, okay. Interesting. Back in those days, in the 1960s, people first seemed to discover gay rights or women's rights or the right to do whatever you liked, instead of what society constantly expected from you, right? And this conformism, this orthodox conformism of the 1950s was broken in a way, right? And individual liberty and the idea that you could be yourself, right? Which you see now everywhere. If you go to the HEMA, there's an advertisement which says "Altijd jezelf," right? So you can buy your stuff in the HEMA to become yourself. It's a nice idea, right? So now it's completely normal for us to be confronted with these kinds of ideas. For the 1960s, it was revolutionary, right? It was seldomly seen, because we needed to adapt before that, and now individual liberty and tolerance were new types of issues that rose. And Ronald Ingelhardt tried to explain this, right? And he used some sort of Maslowian logic. Maslow, you know, yeah, okay. So when basic needs were met and we were more prosperous, we didn't worry too much about putting food on the table the next day, or finding a shelter for our kids or something like that. That was taken care of in the post-war period, and which meant that we could start worry about things that weren't okay yet, right? Which was individual liberty, self-attainment, social cohesion, etc. And that's what became much more important, right? And this is the first step. And this already caused some sort of big breakup in the political system. So here is Ina Brouwer, and here is Marcus Bakker. Marcus Bakker was like a member of the old socialists in the old sense, right? So fighting for the working class and the for people who didn't have anything. And this was Ina Brouwer. Later on, she became I don't know the English word for wethouder. She became
alderman.
She became an alderman in Amsterdam, now the green left capital of the Netherlands, by the way, for the green left. And they broke up. They were in one party and they broke up, right? And they started their own parties. Green left was born basically in that moment, right? So it tore apart the left-wing parties into an old left and a new left. And this new left became, well, ever more popular. Then the second step in this argument is that Piero Ignazi says, well, if you take a look at Engelhardt, he only predicts that everybody becomes more left-wing and more left-wing and more left-wing. So, and confronted with all kinds of other stuff, like the rise of populist parties, he says, well, these are only temporal aberrations of a more general trend. And the more general trend is that everybody increasingly becomes more tolerant. And that's what he constantly says. And then Ignazi says, well, that's bullshit. There's also a silent counter-revolution, a revolution of people who were silent, like you were silent on the Karl Marx University all the time, because then everybody would fight with you or something, right? Oh, but most of the people, obviously not everybody in the 1960s and 70s felt like the new left-wing activists all the time, right? And there's a beautiful book, for instance, by I don't know his first name, but his Lyons. He's a history professor in America, and he has a couple of students every year, a new bunch. And he said, well, okay, you are the kids of the 1960s and 70s generations, right? So so your parents were at Woodstock. Go ask them what they did. Right? Were they at Woodstock? Were they protesting? Were they seizing their democratic power? And every student came back and said, well, my parents didn't do anything. Right? So there was a huge silent majority, and they remained silent for a long time. But at a certain point, they got fed up with this. And they started this a counter-revolution. They started to react against this and started to call for more order in the nation, to call for a ban on immigration, to call for more and stiffer sentencing, etc., etc. Everything for which the new left did not stand for, basically. And the interesting stuff is that this silent counter-revolution wasn't materialistic at all, but was also post-materialist. It didn't have anything to do with how much money you have. It has to do or with economic redistribution. It has to do with basically the ideological counterpart of the new left, right? New right-wing policies. So, and this is from a paper of Jeroen van der Waal and myself. What you can see is that if you measure in political party manifestos, you measure a preference for new right-wing policies, you can see nothing in the post-war period up until, well, basically the 1980s. So new right-wing policies weren't particularly popular, and there was no general trend within this type of policies. But if you take a look at the period following the 1980s, you can see a sharp increase in the popularity of new right-wing ideas. We did a similar analysis for new left-wing ideas, and it's the other way around. First, there was a sharp increase in new left-wing ideas, and then afterwards, nothing really happened, right? So from the 1980s onwards, there's no increase in new left-wing ideas in political party manifestos. This is in Europe. So these are all political parties in Europe in the data set. There's a data set. It's an international collaborative project of basically political scientists coding all political party manifestos in all of Europe and expressing them in percentages. So if they talk about crime in a right-wing way, a lot, like 5 or 6% or so is about this, then this variable gets this score. And you can calculate, the popularity of certain policies. I think
that was a very strong behavioral class that was organized in a way.
Yeah.
There was no left and right.
That's true. In the Netherlands, that was true. And you might think, it's not in my presentation, but I did a lot of research on this. You might think that, for instance, cultural issues, conceived a little bit broadly, were already very important in the Netherlands back in the old days because, when you talk about religion, when you talk about abortion, when you talk about euthanasia or something, these are the issues. But nowadays, when we talk about cultural polarization between political parties, it's always in a secular sense. So it's not about those issues, because everybody in the Netherlands, for instance, now agrees with each other that euthanasia is okay, or abortion, that shouldn't be a problem, or what to do with gays. No problem. Left-wing parties or right-wing parties all think alike, basically. They are tolerant. But now there's a new type of secular cultural polarization on immigration, cultural tolerance, and what to do with criminals, right? And this isn't like in the old days, right? But there's some point there. And it's also one of the reasons why the Netherlands is atypical, in a way, for the rest of Europe, because polarization was more strongly here than in all other nations I know of, right? So
yeah.
Wow. But still, in the Netherlands, it was particularly strong, I would say. Okay. And, a major consequence is that later on, all right-wing parties also started to tear up, right? So first, there was Wilders. Who remembers why Wilders left the liberals? Yeah, why?
Turkey,
exactly, right? It was already about, not an economic issue. It was about identity and whether or not Turkey should be allowed to start negotiating for entering the European Union. And, later on, there was a massive fight, right, for the party leadership between Rita Verdonk and Rutte. This was not photoshopped, by the way. He actually did a press conference like this once. I like it. All right. He doesn't have an animal, but for the rest, it's perfect. But like Marcus Bakker and Ina Brouwer, they also tore up, right, these right-wing parties into an old right-wing party and a new right-wing party. Okay, so, and then the last one is how to explain it. And I would say, if you take a look at Ingoart, there is some sort of idea that that it's economic prosperity. And if I would ask my mother-in-law, we sometimes watch television about politics, and then suddenly she cries out, these people simply don't have any real concerns, right? So that's why they start talking about Black Pete, and she doesn't think it's real politics. She thinks it's a demonstration of people are too prosperous, basically. So there's nothing left to talk about, so people start bullshitting, right? This is what she thinks. Well, I think, and Ingoart basically also thinks this way, right? It's about first taking care of the basic needs, and when those needs are met, then people can start worrying about less important stuff, right? I don't think this way. And I see it as some sort of expression of another process, which is going on for a long time, which is detraditionalization. In earlier days, in the 1950s, everything was, institutionally very stable. right? People went to church or not, people were in a pillar, what to think, what to define as good or bad, it was all clear, right? And nowadays, like the lower educated you described already, and there's a lot of uncertainty in a way, institutional uncertainty, but also moral uncertainty, in which we don't completely know what is good and what is bad. Our parents socialize us completely different than in earlier days. We don't go to church anymore. We don't get socialized about that, about these kinds of issues, which causes some sort of, implausibility, right? So, and then there's two reactions. You can enjoy this and say, well, okay, I'm going to seize this moment. I'm going to enjoy this newly given freedom to determine my own way. Or you can say, well, this has gone too far. I want some moral guidance. And these are the two typical reactions that you get. And I did a paper together with Willem de Koster and a couple of others, which is called One Nation Without God. It's published in English and in Dutch. But when preparing this lecture, I couldn't find the English version, so I took the Dutch table. But here you can see that this affects highly and lowly educated completely different. So people are embedded in a post-Christian morale, who go to church, who believe highly and strongly in all Christian dogmas, react completely differently of the lowly educated who are embedded who are disembedded, I'm sorry, react completely differently from the lowly educated who still go to church. For this interaction term basically says, right, and we did a couple of scales on ethnocentrism, on multiculturalism, and on authoritarianism. You can see that the lowly educated, when they don't go to church, when they don't embrace this Christian morale, this orthodox idea, then they become ethnocentric. Then they become racist in a way. Then they have an authoritarian reaction against everything in society, which leads them to vote for, well, populist types of parties, nativist types of parties. But if the same lowly educated people are embedded in a Christian orthodox surrounding, then there's no effect at all, right? And there's a couple of graphs, but I just chose for this table. It's a very robust finding that for the lowly educated, there's a racist tendency only when they are not institutionally embedded. And for a highly educated, it's completely the other way around, I would say. But for highly educated people, they increasingly become libertarian. They increasingly become more tolerant when they don't go to church. So not going to church has a lot of great effects at the same time for the highly educated. So you cannot say going to church is good or bad, or right? Because it has different types of effects for the different groups in society. Lowly educated people react completely differently, namely racist and conservative and authoritarian, while highly educated people react like in the other way, right? So, and this points at this institutional environment. What did you want to ask?
I think if you would examine that would explain a lot. Because if you would be in an environment where you don't have control, you get apathic.
Okay.
And if you have a religion, you have hope.
Yeah. I think you're right, because later on in this paper, we examine why this interaction actually exists, and then we control for, well, not apathy, but for anomia, which probably is strongly linked, And then we completely explain away this these differences between these two educational categories. And so it is the lowly educated who have a sense of not being heard, not having control on the system, of not feeling at home in their nation, which causes this, right? And the highly educated don't feel this at all. They don't have this cultural malaise. They don't feel discontented whatsoever. And it doesn't lead them to racism or populism. Yeah. I don't know, because here in the Netherlands we only have Christians, so probably there's a lot of more religions, but they refuse to answer our questionnaire, so that's a bit of a problem, right? So I simply do not know whether it also applies to Islam, for instance, or well, Judaism, or well, Buddhism, or something. I don't know. It's an open-ended question, right? I think it does, because, well, basically what religion does is answer moral questions, so you don't have to have them. But I don't know, right? We can figure that out. But probably what I didn't do here is also distinguish between Protestants and Catholics, in which you can also expect some differences, right? Because Protestants are more on their own and are less embedded in a moral story, because they're always individually responsible for their own moral guidance. For Catholics, it's more easy because you just listen to the Pope and that's it, right? So, that's the idea in Catholicism, at least. So, I don't know. We can try to figure that out. But, okay. Okay, and then in the wake of there are two types of consequences. I need to speed up a little bit, I think. There are two types of consequences. People start voting differently, and in the wake of this, this causes some sort of huge realignment in Western politics. So, to show the relations a little bit between ethnocentrism and voting behavior, you can see the VVD and the PVV on the one end for having ethnocentrist electorates, and Greens and D66 in the Dutch Labour Party score lowest on this. And also when you talk about, well, let's say protectionism, protecting your own national economy from, let's say, other types of economies, what we see now all the time in the United States with Trump abandoning all kinds of international trade deals, and TTIP, and etc. If you take a look at this, you can see rather the same types of picture, right? It's nativism which does the trick, you might say. And this causes some sort of realignment. And to make this a little bit clear, there is some sort of idea that, party structures are basically just a reflection of societal structures. So in the polarized system, you might have Catholics, Protestants, socialists, and liberals, and then suddenly some political parties would come up, be frozen in the political party system, representing the interests of these societal groups, which are fighting each other. And this is what always happens. So for instance, if you take a look at Labour, that's an ideal party in this this idea, of course, because Labour appeals to the working class. It is already in the name of their party. Or Christian Democrats also appeals to Christians, basically, right? And this works tremendously well. And this is sometimes forgotten, but in political sociology, people constantly think that, if you find people from a working class voting for a left-wing party, this is a demonstration of this cleavage politics. Well, actually, there needs to be something in between, because, sometimes members of the working class vote for a left-wing party for completely the wrong reasons, right? So, for instance, there's a case of Italian workers of a factory who vote for the communist parties, and you might think it's because of class interests. So that's why they are voting for this. But actually, they just like the leader, or he's cute, or he is in favor of garbage disposal, because in Italy, garbage is often not collected, right? Something like that. And then, strictly speaking, I think you cannot talk about class voting in this way, right? So the cleavage of class voting doesn't work. Okay, so what we have seen throughout the post-war period is some sort of massive decline of class voting. So this traditional idea of the working class voting for a left-wing party and a middle class and the higher classes voting for right-wing parties, that has diminished quite strongly. And there are some sociologists who are actually thinking this indicates the death of class, right? Which is terrible for sociologists, because if there's one staple of sociology, it's stratification, and that there's classes and that people differ from each other with respect to this dimension. And now it suddenly ceased to affect voting behavior. All right, we don't like that. By the way, I think this is why a lot of sociologists are now transferring to health, because we can still demonstrate that the low classes are dying sooner and living unhealthier, etc. So we can still say, well, class matters. Okay, this is on a side note. This is from the PhD thesis from Neil Beerta, and I'm not going to go into the to discuss the details, but what he did was tremendously important, because, well, there was a lot of discussion on how to measure class voting, from very simple cross tabulations to regression models to multi-level modeling to logistic multi-level modeling, including a lot of parties or only two, including a lot of classes or only two. And there are models including 160 classes and all parties, which, well, obscures the idea a little bit of class voting, I think, but still there was a lot of debate. And what he did was measure everything in any possible way to figure out whether or not class voting was declining. And for all kinds of Western countries, basically he found, well, negative trends. And it didn't matter how he measured this, there was a negative trend, which was important. And then all the death of class sociologists basically took this evidence and said, well, you see, now class is dead, right? And here's another demonstration. You can see that actually, this is by Manza and Brooks. You can see how in the United States, and this is replicated also for the Netherlands, so it doesn't really matter where you look, that, for instance, the professional class, so I presume the class in which you are in, or in the class of the managers, that's another class, right? If you're an economist, basically you end up here, I think. If you're a sociologist or a lawyer, you end up here. The professional class started out as a right-wing class and ended up as a left-wing class. And for instance, here are the lowly skilled workers, and here are the skilled workers. They started out as a left-wing class, but there is a diminishing trend, and which has continued also after 1992, right? So there's some sort of realignment in a way. So taken from this, you could say, well, class doesn't explain too much, which has led a lot of people to worry about what's going on. For instance, Thomas Frank, he wrote a book on this, What's the Matter with Kansas? And he found a lot of people, Kansas was a relatively poor state, a lot of people in the working class suddenly started voting for the Republicans, the wrong party, right? And he said, what's the matter with them, right? So everybody's worrying about this. And I think this is rather important, that a class position might represent two things at the same time. People might have a lot of economic capital, might have a lot of income, which, well, necessitates that you vote for a right-wing party, because, well, they will defend your economic capital. And also, there's cultural capital. And if you have a lot of cultural capital, if you read a lot of books, go to museums all the time, consider yourself an arts lover, then You have different types of interests, you have different types of values, you become much more libertarian. And for the lower end of the scale, people who have less economic capital, they also have less cultural capital. This is more or less aligned. But then the work of Pierre Bourdieu basically shows that it starts to deviate at a certain point. Then there are cultural specialists, like librarians. They read a lot, but they earn squat. And economic specialists, like people selling houses, right? They don't read, they never read, but they have a lot of money and a BMW and stuff like that. For instance, did you ever see the house of Donald Trump? Yeah? Okay, that's an indication of low levels of cultural capital. Right? Yeah? So you know he ends up here somewhere, right? He has a lot of economic capital, but not too much cultural capital. Okay. To show that I'm not bullshitting you, this is taken from a Dutch survey, and you can see that there is some sort of funneling effect, right? Where here's the cultural capital, and here's the economic capital. And you can see muziek instrumentenmakers, kunstenaars, musici, auteurs, they don't earn a lot, but they have massive amounts of cultural capital. And here are the commissionarissen, the makelaars, the directeuren, right? They don't have as much cultural capital, but they have a lot of economic capital. Okay. Yeah. But it.
Hmm? Yeah.
They combine this. Yeah. That's why. Obviously, there's always some in between, right? But these are the two flavors, basically, of the middle class. And this corresponds nicely with how political space nowadays is structured. Instead of one left-right continuum, there are two. So if I would ask you what to do with the economy, should we take money from the rich and give it to the poor or not? Your answers, whether or not you're left wing or right wing, would not predict in any way the answers on issues like what to do with immigrants, what to do with criminals, or what to do with individual freedom or something like that. So they're completely unrelated. And you can see this in surveys from the 1950s onwards. It's very stable that there's some sort of bidimensional structure. And basically we took this and said, well, if you are a member of a working class, then you don't have a lot of cultural capital at the same time. I already showed you this. And people with low levels of cultural capital are more authoritarian. And if you are authoritarian, you don't like to vote for, let's say, a left-wing party, right? A traditional left-wing party, because they combine, they are much more libertarian, right? So take a look at Dutch Labour Party, for instance. They always talking about international solidarity. If there's an international crisis, they say, the refugees are welcome here, etc. People who have low levels of cultural capital don't like this, right? So they run the other way to the right-wing parties. But if you are a member of the working class, then you also like to have economic redistribution. You want to take from the rich, give to the poor, some sort of Robin Hood type of policies, which is a perfect reason for you to vote for a left-wing party. Well, we analyzed voting behavior patterns over the complete post-war period for 20 Western European countries. And we found out that this way of voting hasn't decreased. So it is still as important as it ever was, which is hard to imagine, but still, this is what we found. So when you are in a working class, you still want to vote for a left-wing party. However, it has become increasingly difficult for you to do so because this mechanism has increased tremendously in power, right? So political parties started polarizing over this. Personal cultural salience increased tremendously, and this mechanism increased and increased and increased. So if you only take a look at class and left-wing voting behavior, like New Beerta and Mensa and Brooks and the pictures I just showed you, you think class doesn't matter anymore. But if you control for this cultural mechanism, you can still see that it actually does, right? So for traditional economic old right-wing or left-wing parties, there's still hope, I would say. But still, it has become increasingly hard to get those votes, because Wilders is constantly talking about culture, constantly talking about immigrants, and this makes it hard. Okay, so over time, so I'm going to skip this. This is what I just told you. If you take a look at income, there's actually an increasing influence on voting behavior. And if you take a look at education as an indicator for cultural capital, there's also a much stronger influence, but the other way around, which causes people with a low level of education to want to vote for right-wing parties. My conclusion. If you take a look at populism as an antagonism, you could say it's a result of technocratic politics. It's because, sometimes there are technocratic governments which necessitate some sort of ideological redemptive correction. And then some people, especially in the lower end of the political, in the lower end of the socioeconomic spectrum, want to vote for this. And they want to democratize the political system. And if you take a look at populism as nativism, you could see that it is some sort of reaction against the powerful flower power types of policies that have entered politics, and they want to correct that, and which brings some sort of cultural realignment of politics, right? Okay, now my last remark, I promised this already, was on the Dutch Labour Party. Based on this, I wrote an article together with Dick Houtman, a colleague of mine, which was called Arbeiders en Schoolmeesters, Workers and School Teachers. It's an unhappy marriage. Because the schoolmeesters, the teachers, have a lot of cultural capital. They don't have a lot of economic capital, but they have a lot of cultural capital. And within the Dutch Labour Party, there were a lot of people, a lot of school teachers, who wanted to vote for the Labour Party because of these culturally progressive ideals that they had. But then the workers, they had a less cultural capital. They were more authoritarian, more racist, and they don't want a Labour Party which embraces libertarian ideas. So this was some sort of a split electorate in a way. And no matter what they did, if they would move to the new left, culturally progressive left, they would lose the voters of the working class. If they would move to the right, as they recently also tried, they would lose all the school teachers. So actually what we did, and people always say sociologists cannot predict anything. We predicted the end of the Labour Party. And I don't want you to all, basically say you're right, but just take a look at what happened yesterday, right? We can see all the school teachers moving to D66 and the Greens, and we can see all the workers moving to the PVV and the SP, the Socialist Party, which has a much more conservative agenda when it comes to cultural issues. So basically, what we predicted, I think it will turn out to be right. And people would have known this, by the way, because we started a campaign in the media, but when we just started, Michael Jackson died. Right? Okay, so that's it. Thank you very much.